Good afternoon. My name is Clinton Anderson. I want to welcome you to the symposium titled Gwendolyn Keita, PhD, on Advancing the Public Interest, Looking Back and Going Forward. Susan Opotow and I are the co-chairs of the symposium today, but I want to acknowledge Susan and Gayle Morse as the major authors of this symposium, representing the Board for the Advancement of Psychology in the Public Interest. They've done great work in identifying and contacting this stellar set of presenters. Today's program is about acknowledging the contributions of Gwendolyn Keita to psychology over her 45 years in psychology, 40 years of membership in APA, and 30 years of service to the American Psychological Association. And she's giving me a stare. As director of the Women's Programs Office, as associate executive director and executive director of the Public Interest Directorate, as the lead on APA's work on work stress and health conferences, and in a number of other ways in which she has contributed to the management and development of the APA and its promotion of psychology to benefit society and improve people's lives. In today's program, I have the honor of providing the first overview of Gwen's life. I was supposed to be actually introducing her to come up, but she wants to be last, not first, so we're changing the order of the program. But nonetheless, she's going to have to listen to me say all the things I was going to say about her. I want to just reflect on the accomplishments that have occurred at APA under her leadership. Then we have a series of distinguished speakers who will add their perspectives as we try to collectively shine our particular lights on the many facets of Gwen's life in psychology. In January of this year, after nearly 30 years of service to the American Psychological Association, actually it was more than 30 years, slightly, and to psychology, Dr. Gwendolyn Keita retired as executive director of APA's Public Interest Directorate. Just on a personal note, you know, she's gone back to where she is always referred to as home in Aiken, South Carolina. And I haven't talked to her that many times, but every time I have, she's been on her deck and she talks about the lovely lake view. So I think she's doing very well. As executive director, she oversaw public interest initiatives to apply science and practice to address inequities and advance social justice and human rights, supporting APA's core mission to advance the creation, communication, and application of psychological knowledge to benefit society and improve people's lives. In each of her many roles at APA and within organized psychology, Gwen's goal was to create positive change. Before assuming the role of executive director, she served as Associate Executive Director of Public Interest and Director of the Women's Programs Office. In this role, she convened three major interdisciplinary conferences on psychosocial and behavioral factors in women's health. She co-authored numerous books and journal articles on women's issues, women's health and work, stress and health, and presented before the U.S. Congress on depression, violence, and other issues. Her many presentations have addressed civil rights and discrimination, women's health and mental health, depression and intimate violence, occupational stress and health, and many other issues related to the public interest mission. She was instrumental in developing the field of occupational health psychology, beginning with the first occupational stress conference in 1990. Building on this first call to action, she and the conference planning group, partnering with the National Institute for Occupational Safety and Health, and later the Society for Occupational Health Psychology, convened 11 international interdisciplinary conferences on work stress and health. She was also instrumental in the establishment of APA's Journal of Occupational Health Psychology and the establishment of the Society for Occupational Health Psychology. The 12th conference in this series, Work, Stress, and Health 2017, Contemporary Challenges and Opportunities, was held in Minneapolis in June 2017. And APA will continue to convene this conference series under the direction of Dr. David Ballard and APA's Center for Organizational Excellence. Gwen has been an APA member since 1978 and a fellow since 1973. She is a fellow of three divisions: the Society for the Psychological Study of Social Issues, Division 9, the Society for Psychology of Women, Division 35, the Society for Health Psychology, Division 38, and Society for the Psychological Study of Culture, Ethnicity, and Race. Three of those divisions are represented here today by speakers. The fourth, unfortunately, Joe Trimble, was unable to make it. In her many years of service to APA in the field, she has embodied a strong and sustained commitment to mobilizing the science and practice of psychology to address society's most challenging problems and issues. From the time she took her first psychology class in high school and read about social psychological research on changing racial attitudes, she has believed in the power of psychology to do good in the world and create positive change. And she has devoted and continues to devote her life's work to this goal. As I know, because 29 of those years that she worked at APA, I also worked with her in the Public Interest Directorate. In my own acknowledgement of her contributions as I see them, I see her role as ED of the Public Interest Directorate as someone who has overseen the creation of two new offices, the Office of Socioeconomic Status and the Health Disparities Office, both of which have made and will continue to make important contributions to broadening the public interest program portfolio into areas that are at the center of our society's needs. However, I think she would agree that the most significant contribution she has made is to the expansion of the communications activities within the directorate. As I have served as the interim ED over the last 7 months, I have also come to better appreciate the unique perspective and voice Gwen brought to the executive management group of APA and the tireless advocacy for psychology in the public interest that she carried out. Now, I would like to invite the first of our speakers, James Jones, who was the first executive director of the Public Interest Directorate, and for whom both Gwen and I worked for a few years. James?
Thank you, Clinton. Hi, Pam. I've been around for a long time, and I thought I would take this opportunity to just talk very briefly about the context in which the Public Interest Directorate emerged. It was a very interesting and challenging time. I only have 7 minutes, so I'm going to give you a two-decade history in 7 minutes. I'm honored to be part of this celebration of PI's important contributions to APA, the field of psychology, and the citizens of the U.S. and the world, and specifically Gwen's leadership and contributions to this work. I will briefly set the context for public interest in psychology and then share my personal perspective on Gwen. The significant engagement of APA in public interest dates, and I don't know, we can probably go back and find other stuff, but this is where my consciousness starts, to the 1960s Civil Rights Movement and Dr. Martin Luther King. The activities and events that played out over two decades, from 1967 to 1987, is the backdrop to the Public Interest Directorate. In 1967, on September 1st, Martin Luther King Jr. delivered an invited distinguished address to the APA convention, the role of behavioral scientists in the Civil Rights Movement. His speech was reprinted in the Journal of Social Issues in 1968, but while his speech was still in galley proofs, he was assassinated. I think that was a galvanizing event for APA in a lot of different ways. In 1969, George Miller, then president of APA, was introduced, but black students stood up and were invited to the podium to discuss their concern with and desire for APA's involvement in expanding the recruitment and support of black students in psychology. It was a very dramatic thing, and I don't have time to go through all of it, but it was quite a dramatic event. They, Miller gave them the podium, and they described a multiple set of activities that they wanted, including $5 million to advance the issues that they had in mind. They didn't want it to be a check written tomorrow, but they wanted it to be something that was carried out over time. And in some ways, not the way they wanted, it has been part of the program. then when one of the responses to the black students, which was a part, which created the Black Student Psychological Association, BSPA, was to create an office for BSPA in APA. It wasn't an APA office, it was a BSPA office, but APA footed the bill. Then in George Miller, in his presidential address, famously said we needed to give psychology away, which was a specific way to advance human welfare, which I think was part of our mission. I think it's probably been rewritten in a more elegant way to be more encompassing of the goals of psychology. Then in 1971, Kenneth B. Clark was elected president. And in his presidential address, The Pathos of Power, A Psychological Perspective, he ushered in the formation of the Board of Ethical and Social Responsibility, fondly known as BSERP. And so by the early part of the 70s, we had sort of laid a foundation for a variety of organizational approaches to public interest issues. in 1972, APA created the Committee on Equal Opportunity in Psychology, CEOP, which essentially replaced the mission of the Black Student Psychological Association and brought it in-house and made a broad mandate to deal with equity and opportunity. In 1973, the Council Representative established the Committee on Women in Psychology. And in 1974, APA successfully wrote and received a grant to establish the Minority Fellowship Program. In 1978, the Minority Fellowship Program received a grant from the NIMH to host a conference to explore ways in which APA could be more responsive to ethnic minority issues in psychology. That conference, known affectionately as the Dulles Conference, established and was accepted by APA, the Office of Ethnic Minority Affairs, proposed a Board of Ethnic Minority Affairs, which they tabled but didn't defeat. And within 2 years, we had effectively established the Board of Ethnic Minority Affairs. So in that decade, literally, from 1967 to 1978, you see how much movement had taken place at APA. Then in 19, so things went along for a while, but in 1987, the tensions between the practice community and the science community erupted to a point that it was, they concocted a way to give each of them autonomy over their constituencies, over their issues, and to give it a structural reality. So that's when they created the directorate structure. And so there was a practice directorate, there was a science directorate, each having a super board. For science, it was BSA. For practice, it was CAP, and to a lesser extent, BPA. But then, what are they going to do with the rest of the folks, the public interest? And what emerged was that we need to have a public interest directorate. And then Goodstein, who was the executive director at the time, called me and asked me if I would take over as interim executive director. I had avoided every element of governance as to the best of my ability for all the years I was here. But for some reason, it seemed like a good opportunity, so I said yes. So the Public Interest Directorate was created along with the Science and Practice Directorate by the time it came about, it was about 1978 or so. And one of the things that was clear to me, tell me about time, because I wrote this so I would be on time, but now I'm ad-libbing, so I'm going to be long.
Go ahead.
Okay. So Henry's not here. I can use his time.
you can use Henry's time.
So when the directorate structure was created, the entire tension, the focus, the interest was in practice and science. And a public interest was conceived as a special interest advocacy group of people, not really psychology. And it was very palpable, and Gwen very well knows this. And it was my view that we had to do everything we could to demonstrate all the ways in which, in my opinion, psychology was fundamentally public interest psychology. That the only rationale beyond the guild interests of more practitioners and more scientists was, what do we do for people? What do we do to benefit society? And how does all the work that our scientists and practitioners do make the world a better place? And that really is the bottom line for what's valuable about psychology, in my opinion. So we did that, and one of the first things that really got their attention was when we did we had a task force on abortion and responses to abortion. And that task force produced a report which we were able to get published in Science. Now, we're doing a publication in Science on abortion. That changed the game. Suddenly, we were real. We were scientific. We were analytical. We had access to the major instruments of communication. So we did other things. We did a special issue on homelessness, a special issue on HIV and AIDS. We did a lot of things to really bring psychological science and psychological practice to the public. But that political dynamic was still operative, and in trying to engage the leadership in supporting our issues, became clear to me that we needed to funnel all the voices that were public interest into a coherent voice with some political capacity. And so, with great reluctance and some trepidation, and I think a lot of people who supported me in this process had a lot of trepidation, a lot of concern. I recommended that we sunset BSERP, sunset BEMA, change the reporting line of CWP, and ultimately, without going through the long detail, created the board of BIAPI, board of, I forget, whatever that is. That's right, change. That was during the time that Don't Worry, Be Happy was a big hit. So that made it easier to say it. So I think the creation of BIAPI was a very interesting exercise in political organization, in compromise, and in vision, and in cooperation and working together for the greater good. And I hope that BIAPI is still perceived as a body that encompasses that. I left PI in 1992, turning it over to Henry Toms, and if he gets here, I guess he can speak to it. If not, he won't. I didn't mention, well, I'm going to mention in a minute. So I had the opportunity in 2005, I haven't mentioned Gwen too much, in 2005, Gwen had been the deputy director under my tenure. She was the deputy director under Henry in 2005 when Henry retired. She was a candidate for the permanent position. And I was asked to write a letter in support of her candidacy. And I want to just read excerpts of the letter, because that is what my observations about why Gwen is such a magnificent leader, an effective communicator, and a person who has really taken PI to the place that it occupies today. So this was sent to Mike Honecker, who was the COO and I guess chair of the search committee at that time. So, quote, one of my first tasks was to appoint a deputy from the senior PI staff. I chose Gwen because of her strong work ethic, her sincere dedication and commitment to women's issues specifically, and the full range of PI issues more generally. What I particularly like about her manner is that while she's always cordial and collegial, she is not afraid to speak up when she thinks the groups are getting off course. She has a wonderful grasp of the governance enterprise. She supports their activities while simultaneously guiding them along the course of their purpose and goals. She is their colleague and friend, but also provides support in a proper staff role. Her work with women's governance groups has led to the organization of 4 conferences, from which 3 books and several monographs have emerged. And the point is, Gwen gets it done. And Clinton alluded to much of that. Clinton has mentioned the stress in the workplace work. Issues that were really relevant to society but didn't immediately engage science and practice. It was kind of like, you know, Mikey, let Mikey eat it. Give it to Mikey. So they would give it to public interest. So work stress in the workplace was one of the issues they gave to public interest. So we had to figure out what we were going to do with it. And so Gwen was interested in those issues, and we sort of got together, and she took over the management and leadership on it, and the Stress in the Workplace initiative began in 1990. The first conference was here in the Renaissance Hotel in 1990, and then I think next year was in Sweden or something like that. Or maybe 2 years later, every other year, I guess. Anyway, it has become what it has become, and Clinton's already detailed it. But Gwen was from the very beginning the creative lead in all of that work. That wasn't all in the letter. Her work there typifies her work. She is very good at working with people of translating an idea into a workable and successful activity and following up with tangible and meaningful products. One of Gwen's most distinctive qualities is her keen and often divergent viewpoints on things. It was usually Gwen who would offer a perspective that was different from the orthodoxy. And I had to help people through that. She would have been the one to make public note of the emperor's nudity in an earlier time. During my tenure as ED, she was invaluable as her perspective broadened the range of problems we could identify and the solutions we could conceive to address them. I've known Gwen, I wrote this in 2005, I've known Gwen for over 20 years and have the highest regard and respect for her. She is tough-minded but soft-hearted. An excellent combination for a leader. I offer my highest and unqualified endorsement of Gwen for the position of Executive Director for Public Interest at APA, and I was delighted when they selected you, Dr. Keita. So I know I've gone well over, so it was a privilege for me to work with you, Gwen, and to watch from afar after I left as you crystallized and galvanized the work of PI to the extremely important position in APA and in psychology and in the public realm. Thank you for your service, thank you for your leadership, and thank you for your friendship.
Next, I'd like to ask Susan Opotow to come up. She is going to speak about Gwen from the perspective of Division 9, one of the divisions that Gwen is a fellow for, and as well as having been a member of the Board for the Advancement of Psychology in the Public Interest, which she is currently.
The slides aren't going to change until the very end, so there's not much to see up there. Well, first of all, thank you all for being here, and Gwen, thank you so much for coming to this APA meeting. I was so excited to hear you'd be coming, and this session, I think, is a chance to for us all to see you again, which is a great treat, and to think back on a history that you've been very much part of. The history in this room, I think, is for everyone's history, is so relevant to yours and entwined with that. So it's exciting to look around and see who's here. I'm going to reflect on Gwen, but also, as she urged, on the Public Interest Directorate. And the structure of this panel asks us, in some ways, to historicize the public, what it means to have psychology in the public interest. It goes back in time, and it ends with Earl, who will be looking forward, I hope. He'll be our early career member. And I'm very excited about doing that, because the continuity of public interest in psychology is so near and dear to my heart, and I think everybody's in this room. We've all been, and we all are, the beneficiary of amazing collection of activist projects over the decades. And I'm just going to briefly mention a timeline on Saturday, which emerged out of BIAPI, that's called Looking Back in Our 125th Year, Exploring American Psychology's Past. And it includes much of the work that's been done that's touched on and influenced the Public Interest Directorate. It'll be 3 o'clock in room 158, the program. Okay, so in working on that timeline, it became clear to me that there was a whole range of issues and people who started to come online in psychology in the 30s, about the same time as the New Deal. And they were interested in public work and fostering public good. And then from the 50s on, there was this tremendous emergence of divisions, and there was also ethnic minority involvement in psychology, women's issues in psychology, and a whole range of activist projects that fell one after the other in very interesting order. And as I'm not going to go over the history, because James is in the room and he just did a wonderful job on that, but when BSERP and CIMA and the BIMA gave way to BIAPI, we saw so many, I think after that, so many structural changes in psychology that were so interesting. I couldn't help but reflect on my own history while doing this. And as I entered the field of psychology as a graduate student, I'm a non-traditional student, so it was later than you think, that it was just after the Dulles Conference in 1978, is that right? Yeah, and when and that's when all the changes were starting to take place. And so at that point, I hadn't realized what had been going on within my field, sort of the developmental context in which I came of age as a psychologist, and how that influenced who I am and what I've done since. But I came to psychology, like so many of you, because I understood psychology to be a place, a profession in which we could do good work. And my beacons were, there were two beacons for me. One of them was SPSSI, because of its focus on understanding and addressing chronic social issues in society through research, and BIAPI, which was advancing social justice and well-being for all people, basically overlapping and complementary goals. So when I entered the field, Henry and James had been actively involved in a lot of the changes that had occurred over the prior years, and Gwen was at that point heading the Women's Program Office. I had been the student of another tough-minded, tender-hearted psychologist, Morten Deutsch, who died in March of this year. And he, in turn, was the student of Kurt Lewin, and both of them prided themselves on being the tough-minded and tender-hearted scientist. And I think that that's a very important part of SPSSI and of BIAPI and of your work, Gwen. So I found the Women's Program Office incredibly impressive in its work. It was at a very important time, I think, in our society and in psychology, but eliminating gender bias in all aspects of psychology and all spheres of psychology, with a special emphasis on work, stress, and health. For me, that influenced everybody's lives. So I want to go back for a moment in history and say that before coming to APA, and this is evident in Gwen's scholarship, she was mentored by the remarkable Carolyn Robertson Peyton, who was lived from 1925 to 2001. And Gwen describes her as, quote, committed to making a difference, open to new opportunities, willing to do whatever she felt was right, no matter the consequences. And you can see that there's a sort of a similarity between, I mean, I could use those exact same words to describe Gwen. And Gwen and Carolyn were both alumna of Bennett College in Greensboro, North Carolina, although they were 25 years apart in that college. And when Gwen describes Carolyn as having a sharp wit, making incisive comments, able to see through verbiage, and passionate about social issues, I see an important continuity across generations of black women who are important leadership roles. Two. I think I'm getting there, because this page I think we were skipping. So, I'm going to briefly describe a project which I did when I was a SPSE president in 2009, and I collaborated with Gwen in the Public Interest Directorate. I wanted the SPSE program at SPSE's 2009 APA meeting in Toronto to highlight the rich potential for theory and practice of partnerships between psychology and diverse and economically challenged communities. I appreciated that Canada had a more enlightened approach toward their newcomers than we had toward immigrants at the time, and it's even more stark now. So the SPSE program was called Psychology Community Engagement, Partnering for Societal Change. And it was, the SPSE program was led by the wonderful University of Toronto psychologist, Michaela Hinea, who arranged a tour of community centers for psychologists to learn about the processes and outcomes of partnering as a means for engagement of both sides in community events. I envisioned this as a project that would include all APA members, not just SPSE members. And so I turned to Gwen to ask if the Public Interest Directorate would play a role in this. And it was a 5-second conversation. You know, we just agreed that it would work. And I thank you so much for that. I had the great pleasure of working with Kiona King Cicada. And it was a beautiful day in the field. We visited several centers. We had professors, graduate students, health, NIH staff, APA staff, postdocs, and in an article, we visited programs that discussed such topics as action research on gunfights, teen sexuality, research by homeless and former psychiatric patients on supportive housing, and immigrant-initiated projects. People who were part of the program described it this way: entering the actual community to learn about thriving community-based research projects and having partners share their perspective was enlightening. Somebody else said the palpable love community members gave to their projects and the images they showed representing community problems and problem-solving together were so impressive. And another said, I grew envious that Canada welcomes their newcomers rather than assault, detain, intimidate, and threaten and deport them. Michelle Fine wrote about this in her poetic way, in ways that echoed Carolyn Peyton's paper, Who Should Do the Hard Things, Who Can Do the Hard Things. Michelle wrote, with yellow buses and on the second floor of malls, with science and spoken word and poetry, with affects of joy and anger, with rigor and outrage, we must do the hard things. The video of this project is still available on SPSE's website. It's called The Road to Community Partnerships, and I encourage it for any classes that you teach. So in conclusion, there is going to be a slideshow. That'll be very, very quick. In conclusion, these tidbits that include the sweep of history and the particulars of lives, I want to close with joining with you to celebrate Gwen's lifelong commitment to equality, justice, inclusion, and her deep and unshakable conviction that all people are of equal worth. Like her mentor, Carolyn Peyton, Her enduring contributions to public interest will continue in the work of the many people she has inspired and she has nurtured. It's been a real privilege to know Gwen and to work with her over this time. So the slideshow, it's no text. I'm sorry. It's just images. Oh, God. She wants me to do the password. No. Ugh.
I love that. Any tech help is always helpful. Why is it not starting the slideshow?
I don't know. I was just here. Okay. We're off. I have to do full screen, though, right? It is full screen. Okay, great. This is the bus trip. This is the bus. You saw Fiona there for a second. These are community members. More bus tripping. These are community members who are educating us on the bus. Community members, this is a man who spoke about the work with the homeless. He says he was a paranoid schizophrenic, and it shows. He gave a beautiful talk on research. This is Gwen at her valedictory at Consolidated One last September. It was a very, very beautiful talk. This is Gwen at the reception for her that evening. And that's it.
So next, I would like to ask Melba Vasquez to come to the podium to talk about Gwen and probably other things from the viewpoint of Division 35 and many other viewpoints.
Many other viewpoints, that's right. Good afternoon. I'm so honored to be a part of this. This is really awesome. I think I can say I knew her when. I knew Gwen way back when. I was on the Board of Social and Ethical Responsibility in Psychology from 1981 to 84. I was very young. If they called us ECPs back then, I would have been an ECP, Earl, like you are now. Are you still an ECP? Yeah. My first contact with the Committee of Women in Psychology was as liaison from BSERP to CWP. Gwen, you were a member of CWP, as I recall, at the time. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Nancy Rousseau was a women's program officer, director. And I have to stick to my notes, otherwise I'll go over. The CWP was established, as James said, in 1973 and came out of a number of resolutions developed soon after a group of women who established an outside organization, the Association of Women in Psychology, which is still very active, presented an historic 52 resolutions to council that dealt with employment, education, child and health care facilities, psychological theories and practice, conventions, equity and decision making, and the general status of women. CWP was established and continues to address critical issues facing women currently and in the future. I was later a member of CWP, and I believe you were director at that time, Gwen, is that right? Okay. And I then became the first chair for the Board for the Advancement of Psychology in the Public Interest, BAPI. BSERP and BEMA were combined to establish BAPI, as James said. I know that Gwen was instrumental in ensuring that the Women's Program Office and the Committee of Women in Psychology continue to work to further the major purpose of the APA to advance psychology as a science and a profession as a means of promoting human and health and human welfare. by ensuring that women achieve equality as members of the psychological community in order that all human resources be fully actualized. Gwen co-authored books on women and depression, male violence against women, healthcare for women, with others. CWP has also worked closely with Division 35, Society for the Psychology of Women, which has supported special projects such as the Leadership Institute for Women in Psychology and a Museum Day initiative more recently. I also know that as PI director, when Gwen became PI, she was supportive of WPO, but she was also adamant that other programs in PI were appropriately supported as well. Because the Board of Ethnic Minority Affairs was merged with BSERP to become BIAPI, many of us, as James said, felt a diminishment of status from a board to a committee. We went from the Board of Ethnic Minority Affairs to the Committee of Ethnic Minority Affairs. Yes, I was one of the ones that gave James a hard time. He doesn't forget. I was hoping he'd forgotten about that. I really did give him a very hard time. I think it was at a caucus meeting. Was it? I don't remember. For me, it felt awful because I'd gotten calls from people and said, I was council rep from Division 45, and I was tasked to not go along with that, to oppose that move. And so I felt a responsibility to give you a hard time, James, when you're trying to present that. Sorry. I formally apologize for. But I was doing my job. Okay. James, Henry, and Gwen all have worked hard to empower SEMA and the other committees under the Public Interest Directorate. They supported the development of other structures that have allowed us to more actively address the grand challenges in society. One of the things that's funny is I keep hearing from people from all of our diminished groups, if you will, our oppressed groups, that we don't feel like we're at the table. I don't know that anybody ever really feels that they're at the table. Isn't that right? But we try. So Gwen has lived and breathed and worked hard to promote fairness and empowerment among the groups in PI. That's been a theme that I associate with Gwen. She's always really an advocate for all the groups. Now, we know that the current atmosphere in this country is regressive and threatening to the progress that has been made. As James said, Dr. Martin Luther King spoke to us 50 years ago at this convention. And he appealed to us to use our science to help defeat racism. And I think the structures of PI was a huge move, either it may have been inadvertent, but a huge move to try to do that, to apply our science to try to solve those grand challenges in society. But I don't think it's enough, especially when we have atmospheres like we do right now in this country. And so we should strive to continue to make Dr. King's call 50 years ago in this association for research in the service of social justice in our journey to justice and healing. So Earl, you have your job cut out for you. You're the future of the BIAPI. I want to personally thank Gwen for all that she's done, also on the behalf of many others. When I was APA president, by the way, her staff supported two of my three major task forces. I see some of the staff here, and I know she was such a strong supporter to make sure that my task forces on immigration and task forces on discrimination worked hard. I think James was on the task force on discrimination. Let's see if anybody else was here, was on there. So I do want to acknowledge and express heartfelt appreciation, Gwen, for your passion, your contributions, your sacrifices in promoting the public interest. You're an extraordinary psychologist and an amazing advocate for all that we care about. Thank you very much.
I can't believe I was here.
I should have given you that signal earlier. Next, I'd like to invite Helen Coons to come up. She is going to speak about Gwen from the viewpoint of Division 38.
Thank you. G-
Good afternoon. I am completely delighted and honored to be here and to speak about Dr. Keita's distinguished contributions, especially as they relate to health psychology, although I certainly won't limit my comments to that. Let's see if we can get these to go forward. Dr. Keita, your leadership and legacy is far and long and deep in so many ways. When I reflected on all the contributions that you've made and the ways in which you've impacted both PI and the association and the public and many of us as individuals, several issues stood out. First, your attention to consistent attention to vulnerable populations and underserved communities. Second, your insistence on taking our high-level science and translating findings on psychosocial, behavioral, and sociocultural factors, not just to education of psychologists, but to consumer education, to prevention and interventions, treatment interventions, to health and community settings, and certainly to public policy. Perhaps one of the most distinguished contributions you've had in my mind is the deep collaborations and partnerships that you created, not just with federal agencies, but healthcare groups, philanthropic groups, and consumers. In addition, without a question, you have had diverse and timely programs that are incredibly consistent to this day with APA's mission to benefit society and improve people's lives. Early on, you were an author on a major publication about the impact of male violence against women at home, at work, in communities. Soon after the release of this book, you brought to APA and to our nation some of the most instrumental and creative conferences and products that we've seen and continue to this day to have lasting impact. The 1994 Conference on Psychosocial and Behavioral Factors in Women's Health, Creating an Agenda for the 21st Century. The 1996 conference extended the dialogue about research, prevention, treatment, and service delivery in both clinical and community settings. Those two meetings were followed up by what we would do to actually enhance or improve women's health and well-being. And we all know that we improve health and the health and well-being of women, we improve the health and well-being of families and communities. In addition, the 2000 Summit on Women and Depression. Gwen didn't just focus on enhancing outcomes, but was instrumental in authoring what's called the Research Agenda for Psychosocial and Behavioral Factors in Women's Health. In the decades since this document, we've seen a dramatic increase in the understanding of psychosocial, behavioral, and sociocultural factors affecting diverse women across the lifespan. I can't underestimate how instrumental this document and Gwen's leadership was in creating a generation of psychologists who are interested in this area and a research agenda at the NIH and the translation of these findings at so many levels. In addition, as a result of these instrumental and creative meetings, Gwen was the author or co-author of a series of books in women's health that were unprecedented at the time and continue to be major pieces of writing. Early on, you did a book on women and depression, which then followed up with an outstanding interprofessional, way before we even used that word, interprofessional summit on women and depression that resulted in, again, an evidence-based, highly translational volume that affects so many women's lives. I might add that this was decades before the Harvard School of Public Health and UN finding on the global impact of depression. Since I've been asked to talk from a health psychology perspective, I want to broaden the list of ways in which Gwen's work is related to health and PI's interests in health. Certainly, the work on mental health and abortion was instrumental, but you've gone on under your leadership, PI, and started to look at smoking and substance abuse, HIV and AIDS, stress and health, obesity and health, adults with diminished capacity, caregiving, the needs of adults with disabilities, and most recently, men's health. Perhaps one of the most important, I think, legacies you leave the association is how to collaborate and use consultants in so many levels. This is a short list that I could think of off the top of my head of groups that you have worked with at a federal level, at a foundation level, across the health professions, and across consumer groups. And to this day, I will never forget your involving Billy Avery and the Black Women's Health Project in one of our early health conferences, and what it meant to have powerful activist and consumer language helping us translate our outstanding science to community interventions. And I think we have are all deeply grateful for your insistence on interprofessional and intra-agency collaborations that to this day have a lasting effect, and we increasingly see now at all levels of the association. Thank you. Not surprisingly, I'd like to step away from the health area for just one moment. In 1995, ELAM, the Executive Leadership for Academic Medicine Program, was founded to ensure that physicians were at the highest echelons of leadership across the 120 plus medical schools in our country. That program has gone on and continued to be very successful. A couple years after the founding of ELAM, Gwen and I started to talk about the importance of training women in psychology and leadership development. I'm pleased to share with you, as one of the founding chairs, that the APA Leadership Development Program for Women in Psychology is celebrating its 10th anniversary this year, and over 300 women have gone through that program. Individuals who participate in LIWP come from academic medicine, clinical, consulting, nonprofit, and government settings. It wouldn't have happened without Gwen's early support and underscore and focus not just on that we're not just preparing more women to be more to be effective and more diverse women for leadership, but that as leaders we impact social change in organizations, institutions, and communities. And LIWP would not have happened without your longstanding support, and so many of us are so grateful for your getting and understanding the role of leadership development for women across the lifespan. Gwen, I think one of the most important things I want to say to you in terms of your leadership and legacy is that you never go very far from being creative. You always bring your integrity, your wisdom, your grace, and your collaboration to anything you do. And I see that now as a member of the board of directors. I have the privilege of working with so many of your fine staff who continue, and now Clinton staff and PI, and that's as powerful as ever among, and it's a wonderful legacy to leave. I think the last thing I want to say is whether it's health or any of the other amazing parts of PI that happened under your direction, you've helped all of us understand that what we do makes a difference. What we do really matters. That's true for PI, it's true for the American Psychological Association, and all of us. We are so grateful and so excited for you. We miss you and want to congratulate you and say thank you.
And next, I would like to invite David Ballard, who is the Assistant Executive Director for APA's Center for Organizational Excellence, to come and talk about Gwen's work stress and health conferences.
Thank you, Clinton, and thanks for the invitation to be here today to speak. And I'm honored, and the history that's in the room and the important work that has been done by the people in the room. seeing the photos from the activities and the photos of Gwen on the bus and heading out to all of those events. It really gives me some context, because when Gwen says those hard things to hear and challenges the status quo, people, I always heard people say that she was tripping all the time, and I interpret that in a totally different way, but I guess they meant it literally. So all this important work that's been done, I'm glad sort of that I'm not an early career psychologist anymore, because the pressure to carry that forward, I mean, Earl has a lot on his shoulders at this point, so don't mess it up. There's a lot of really good things that have happened. So after nearly 30 years of service, Gwen retired earlier this year, and her work addressed civil rights and discrimination, women's health and mental health, depression, intimate violence, occupational stress and health, many other issues that are related to APA's public interest mission. She devoted her career to applying the science and practice of psychology to address inequities, to advance social justice, and improve people's lives. Gwen has a passion for advancing a broad view of diversity that I hope we take and carry forward in the work that we do. So in addition to focusing on women's issues and ethnic minorities, that included overseeing LGBT issues, aging, disability issues, poverty, socioeconomic status, health disparities, violence prevention, HIV/AIDS, and the list goes on and on. And so even though we worked in different parts of APA, I started out in the practice directorate and then moved over into the Office of Strategic Programs, and she was in the public interest directorate, and we were often working on different projects at the time that Gwen was there. Her vision for the role that psychology had and could play in society had a big impact on me, and probably more than she's even aware of, because our paths did not cross directly all that often. In fact, one of my more memorable experiences in my almost 14 years that I've been at APA now, excuse me, was speaking along with Gwen at the Arkansas Psychological Association. So we were there at an event, both speaking. They were commemorating the 50th anniversary of the 1964 Civil Rights Act, and they were honoring some icons of civil rights advocacy in the Little Rock community. And I spoke first at the event, so I was Gwen's opening act, so to speak. And so I brought this high-level treatise of promoting equality in the workplace and a diverse workforce, and I think those words still resonate today, and in fact, maybe even more so now than they did a few years ago. And our work is far from done in this area. We can't become complacent in the glow of past victories, frozen by the fear of ramifications in our currently polarized political climate, or perfectionistic in our desire to wait for just the right moment or circumstances. As Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. wrote when he sat in that jail cell in Birmingham, the time is always ripe to do what is right. This is the same notion that shone through in the work that Gwen did. And as a side note to the event that I was talking about, Gwen had some travel delays that day, so she was late scrambling into the event at the very last moment. In fact, she came into the venue right as I was finishing my speech. I was figuring out stretch, because she wasn't there yet, and she was being introduced next. So I had given this powerful high-level speech about this. So Gwen comes in just as I wrap up, walks in from the back of the room, comes around, sets her things down on the chair, comes up, makes her way to the stage, and she told personal stories about the work that she had done in the community and the relationships that she had built with people there. And at the end, she broke into song. She's laughing. This is her last hurrah. So if you applaud enough after she speaks, maybe you'll actually hear it here today. No pressure, Gwen. But she broke into song following those personal stories about her involvement in the community, the relationships that she built. And that moved the audience more than any high-level aspirational talk ever could have. And that is just one small example and one moment alone of what I personally learned from Gwen about how to make the world a better place. So I'm honored to and humbled to have stepped in to pick up the work of the Work Stress and Health Conference. And at the recent conference we just had in Minneapolis, Dr. John Howard, the director of the National Institute for Occupational Safety and Health, presented an award to Gwen, and unfortunately she couldn't be there that day. So you're gonna get an extra speaker right now. He can't be here today, but I'm gonna read the remarks that he made about Gwen because I think it perfectly captures her role. So it was nearly three decades, these are the words of Dr. John Howard, it was nearly three decades ago that NIOSH showed up on the doorstep of the American Psychological Association. It was the beginning of a new era in the occupational health field, one in which the field was starting to come to grips with the fact that job stress was a serious threat to the well-being of workers and to the prosperity of organizations as well. Who better to partner with NIOSH in confronting this threat than the world's largest professional association of behavioral scientists? This partnership continues today and has much to show for itself. Research, training, and practice in occupational health psychology have flourished. The occupational health community is better equipped than ever to deal with today's seismic changes in the nature of work. NIOSH could not have asked for more. Partnerships like this may begin with signatures of CEOs on a cooperative agreement or a memorandum of understanding, but someone in the organization needs to carry the banner and shoulder the load. For APA, that person was Dr. Gwendolyn Keita. Dr. Keita was there on day one, persuading APA of the merits of engagement with NIOSH, then together with APA colleagues, shepherding three decades of APA investment in occupational health and well-being of working people. Products of this investment include a new journal, a scientific society, and graduate training programs in occupational health psychology, and of course, the conference series. Indeed, a new discipline of occupational health psychology was born. And who better or more natural to lead this effort at the APA than someone who has dedicated their career to uplifting populations at risk in society? During her tenure at APA, Dr. Keita was committed to promoting the equitable and just treatment of all segments of society through the science and practice of psychology, first as director of the APA Women's Program Office and then as executive director of the APA Public Interest Directorate. During her career, Dr. Keita was a recipient of nearly a dozen major awards recognizing her contributions to the welfare of girls, women, and racial and ethnic minority populations. Today, we add to this recognition with the installment of a new standing award by the Work Stress and Health Committee. This award acknowledges outstanding contributions by researchers and practitioners in psychology, occupational health, and allied fields to the advancement of social justice and the welfare of working people. We're proud to present, with our deepest respect, admiration, and appreciation to Dr. Keita, the Work Stress and Health Conference inaugural Gwendolyn Keita Award for Social Justice and the Welfare of Working People. So I'm humbled to pick up this baton and carry it forward. The work of the conference where Gwen's legacy lives on, not only through the award that we've established for the conference, but also because it has actually increased the focus on the role of social justice in this setting, truly a merging of all of the areas that Gwen worked on. So I hope I can do it justice. Thank you.
Next, I'd like to invite Gayle Morse, who is the immediate past chair of the Board for the Advancement of Psychology in the Public Interest, to come up.
Skenekoa, Nyawa, Agwego. That's Ganyagahage, or as you know, Mohawk. And it means, I hope I find you at peace, Gwen. And Agwego means all my relations. So many of you I've worked with, many of you I will work with, I hope. And so welcome, Agwego. When I first thought about saying something about Dr. Keita, I went, oh, this will be a breeze. She knows, you know, she's done everything. And then I thought, oh no, this won't. This is going to be very difficult to describe the accomplishments that she's had in 5 minutes. And then I saw the list of people who were presenting and I went, oh, okay, now I see why. We've got 5 minutes. We have all these people that have wonderful things to say. So, but what I wanted to talk about, I wanted to come from a more personal perspective and talk about what I learned from Gwen for as a leader. I'd heard of Dr. Keita for many years, but I first met her when I was elected to serve on the board for the advancement of psychology, or BIAPI. And I was really immediately struck by her genuine openness, her kindness, her welcoming nature. And I saw that as a sign of a great leader. In my mind, she embodied the characteristics that Dr. Joseph Trimble talks about in his TED Talk, where he talks about leadership from a cultural lens. And from his talk, he talks about some important characteristics: integrity, authenticity, adaptability, collaborative, honesty, a great communicator. So when I first met Gwen at the first meeting, there was a particularly difficult discussion, as you might imagine, in BIAPI, there's some difficult discussions. And there was some dissension, and yet there's Gwen, calm, cool, graceful, mediating all the conversations. She was the perfect example of how to be strong, yet soft and calm when there's some difficult things. It was clear to me that her authenticity and her integrity are pillars of her strength in leadership. Now, if any of you have served on BIAPI, or any public interest committee for that matter, you know that there is an enormous amount of work. And sometimes it can be overwhelming how much work there is. And it seems insurmountable. However, Gwen was able to shepherd us through and be an inspiration to our team. She encouraged people to be collaborative so that we could get the work done. She encouraged people maybe from different areas to work together to complete a task. She helped us to adapt to changing circumstances. As you know, things change sometimes very quickly. And I can only surmise that her ability to do that came from experience and a clear sense of self. So her collaborative nature and adaptability were pillars of her skills and ability to overcome difficulty in changing conditions. At one point, when I was chair of BIAPI, I had a difference of opinion with Gwen. And at the end of a very, very long, exhausting day, she sat down and she listened. She listened to me. She was able to clarify where we agreed, where we disagreed, and how we could look at things from a different perspective and it would be okay. That discussion shaped me as a leader. And the importance of using your listening skills to be a clear communicator and to use your honesty as a pillar of your leadership. In sum, growing up in Ganyagahege culture, leaders always listened carefully to all people, including the youngest people, including the people who were not yet leaders. There was no hierarchy, but rather a recognition of the equality of all people. Gwen showed me how to do this. She showed me how to accomplish in a hierarchy of a hierarchy-oriented organization, how to manage that and look at the equality of all people. I'll always be grateful for Dr. Keita, kind, gracefully, gently guiding me to learn the leadership skills that are consistent with my cultural worldview and will help me bridge my worldview with the complex and convoluted culture of APA. So thank you, Gwen, and I'm so proud to be able to thank you for your work.
And next, Earl Turner, who will be the last formal speaker, but I bet we have a number of people in the audience who will want to speak. Earl is the current chair of the Board for the Advancement of Psychology in the Public Interest.
So the pressure is on, definitely, after all of these great speakers that have just come up today and being the early career psychologists who actually, just completed now my eighth year since I've actually earned my degree. There's definitely a lot of pressure to add to what's been already said today about Dr. Keita and all of her work. So I'm just going to try my best to make a couple of remarks and really add to what's already been said regarding to her accomplishments and what she's done in terms of her contributions to the field. As was noted, I'm the current chair of BIAPI, and when I stepped into my role as being a member of BIAPI, I definitely recognized that Dr. Keita was the perfect example of what is considered to be a public interest psychologist. Her work has demonstrated passion for advancing psychology for the public, and one of the things that I've never told her personally, and anyone for that matter, is that as a graduate student, reading and receiving the Monitor articles and seeing all of her work and what she's done, definitely was something that was very inspiring to me as a student and now as an early career professional. And so when I actually was voted to serve on BIAPI, it was a little bit intimidating to be in her presence. But she was a very warm and caring, as was mentioned several times today. And it definitely made me feel welcome, and her presence and leadership definitely energized me in terms of really wanting to continue to be involved in psychology and specifically APA. It's really hard for me to put into words all of her accomplishments, and definitely, as been stated today, she's made significant contributions to psychology and specifically to psychology in the public interest. She's been instrumental in being an advocate for bringing science to the public and to many of the communities that we serve. Make sure I don't mess with this computer again. To the communities that we serve, and as was noted, she was very instrumental in the creation of the Office of Health Disparities that we currently have at APA. Just to highlight a few of her accomplishments related to health disparities, she has been an advocate for issues related to disparities among boys and men, specifically collaborating and forming partnerships with a number of organizations. More specifically, I wanted to note Black Greek letter organizations that she has collaborated with to address initiatives related to disparities among boys and men, specifically noting the impact of the school to prison pipeline, issues related to preschool suspension, more recently, looking at issues related to aggressive policing policies and communities of color and how they impact the mental health of boys and men. Dr. Keita has also been instrumental in a number of different congressional briefings that have been noted on some of these issues today related to eliminating health disparities among vulnerable populations, including boys and men, as well as issues related to policing. Early career psychologist and someone who is very involved and active in social media, I have to comment on Dr. Keita's work in terms of the public interest and their social media presence. I might be mistaken, but I believe she was one of the first within the public interest to actually start a social media Twitter account for public interest, which has been very active more recently in a number of different initiatives related to issues related to health disparities. More recently, we just had a Twitter chat on disparities for Minority Mental Health Month. And this is an initiative that I would personally work with following the Public Interest Leadership Conference, which was very, Dr. Keita was very instrumental in establishing in 2015. The main purpose of this leadership conference was really to help shape how psychologists give psychology away. And this specific conference involved helping psychologists become more effective in disseminating information, translating research and implementing best practices with advancing health equity, providing psychologists with the knowledge and skills to actually give psychology away, and also being more effective in communicating the value of psychological science and how it may impact the public and society. So as has been noted, there is a lot of pressure for the future of psychology to actually build upon the work of what Dr. Keita has done. I cannot speak to these issues actually being addressed, but I think these are some of the concerns that as an association, we definitely need to keep in mind in terms of being able to address some of these needs of related to these particular populations. One of the things that I wanted to note is in regards to reform of the justice system, and we know that there have been a number of incidents within the past couple of years related to police community relations, and efforts need to be put in place to not only address improvement in terms of how we train police officers and their interactions with communities of color, but also looking at how we actually address the needs of individuals within the justice system, most specifically making sure that we are engaging in providing mental health services for these populations who oftentimes are not served appropriately in those particular settings. I also wanted to know specifically related to interventions on suicide prevention in youth. And what I noted recently, one of the goals of the Healthy People 2020 initiative is to improve health disparities. And specifically to youth, it's noted that there is some improvement according to the current status of the Healthy People 2020 initiative. However, what we note is that specifically to African-American and Black youth, there tends to be a continued disparity in terms of their improvement. And so I think this is an area that we particularly need to address. So just to kind of quote some of the data that I just noted related to some of these issues is that this particular population, sorry, my notes, continues to have a huge gap in terms of their rates of utilization of services, and that tends to not reach the benchmark of 80% that the Healthy People 2020 has actually set as the goal. And then one final note that I wanted to make a note of is that we need to continue to address this issue related to the preschool to prison pipeline. And there has been significant efforts within the public interest to address this particular issue. The data does note that specifically for African-American children, they're 18% of preschool children, but they're about 48% of children that actually receive out-of-school suspension rates. And so one of the efforts that has been put in place by public interest, specifically through the Office of Health Disparities, is the Building Blocks for Preschool Success. And this particular program actually provides resources to be able to address some of those issues related to the preschool to prison pipeline. And in closing, I wanted to again extend my thanks for Dr. Keita and all of her work and her contributions to psychology. Thank you.
And now, last but obviously not least, Gwendolyn Perrier Keita herself. Come.
Let me start by thanking Susan and Gayle for organizing this and BIAPI. I must say that it was a lot easier listening to everybody else first. before speaking, and so the presentation that I had prepared now doesn't make sense to give. So you'll just have to listen to me respond. I wanted to say something about Bonnie Strickland, but I know she said she would have to leave before the end. But Bonnie Strickland was president early in my career here at APA, and my first presidential task force that I staffed. It was really wonderful watching Bonnie pull together all of these different people, not only psychologists, but community people, congressional representatives, people from all over, media folk. And we had the major meeting in New York. Now remember, this was my first presidential task force. This is my first task force, period. I'd only staffed CWP, which at that time had 9 members. So we had a dinner. We had worked all day, very hard, very interesting. We had a dinner in New York. And we were at 3 different tables. I got the bill. This is probably not what you would think I was going to. And almost fainted. And I said, oh my Lord, I'm going to lose my job. Because we did have some guidance on what to spend on meals. This was way past the guidance that we had received. And later I said to Bonnie, I'm really concerned because this task force has not been funded yet, and we have this humongous bill for dinner. And Bonnie, in her Bonnie way, said, don't worry, everything will be all right. So that was one of my earlier experiences. And I think later on, this everything will be all right continued. You know, you can figure out pretty much everything. I'm not going to, as I said, give my presentation because so many of the things that I have wanted to talk about in terms of history of the Directorate and APA have already been said. But the things that I wanted to say would give you an idea of my love for APA and psychology. I think Clinton said that, and many of you have already heard me talk about growing up in the segregated South and taking a psychology class when I learned about all of the research on attitude change. And I felt something. I'm saying, these people can make a difference. In the segregated South, attitude change about prejudice, racism, discrimination, and all was very close to my heart, especially given that that was a time of major violence around the civil rights movement. I would go home every evening and watch the news where you would see black men and women being beaten, spat upon, hosed, dogs set on them. And so those things were very, very painful and meaningful. And to think that psychology might be able to change things and make a difference meant a lot. Also, when I went on to college, you've heard that I went to Bennett College in Greensboro, North Carolina. And many of you will know that Greensboro, North Carolina is where the sit-ins started. So over my years at Bennett, we would have, although we complained regularly, Vespers every Wednesday and chapel every Sunday. But we had wonderful speakers. And over those years, there were several speakers who talked about the role of Bennett women doing the sit-ins. Bennett, for those of you who don't know, is an all-women's college. Even though you heard about the North Carolina A&T guys who sat in and started the sit-in movement at lunch counters, the planning of those meetings took place at Bennett. Martin Luther King came to Bennett and met with others to plan those meetings and to help when people were in jail and so forth. But the Bennett women were also very involved. I didn't know this before I went to Bennett because you never heard that on the news. And this professor, who all of us thought was mean, uncaring, hard, good, but mean and uncaring, talked in our chapel one day about that and going to the pens. They were in cattle pens. They weren't in jail. They, I guess, was 2 minutes to jail. And having tears run down his eyes talking about that, but the sacrifice that you make to make the world a better place and to change things for the future. And these are things that have influenced me coming to psychology. And so it was great coming to APA when this seemed like, this is a part of what I'm supposed to do. And to be able to do it in many ways, small ways at first, but then as you learn more about getting things done, bigger ways. And I thank James for his flexibility and being willing to put up with my questioning and pushing in those early days, and then later Henry, for allowing me the freedom to organize and try to get grants. We were the first ones, I think, who really pushed to get grants to do things that there was not money to do. But APA, I mean, would give you resources to pull together task forces and to work with your committees to do some of these things that were important to do. Conferences on that the first conference on depression, that task force that Bonnie had, was very interesting in a number of ways. The results of it made a difference because APA tended to speak to psychologists. When we have our convention, as you all know, we spoke to the people who were in the room, other psychologists. But during that time, there was something that they called a public meeting, apparently, that they did away with because people didn't come from the public. They would have it outside somewhere. But we had one on women and depression that was full. It was a shock to everybody, but depression was such an issue for so many people that it was full. One day I'm sitting in my office and I get a phone call from our service center. What's going on up there? We're getting all of these calls from these women asking for some publication on depression. What's going on? We had no clue. But Ellen McGrath was on the Phil Donahue show. Some of you are too young, but that was before Oprah, talking about the task force report on women and depression. And women from all over were calling in to try to get this publication because it began to let people know that they could come out of the closet with their depressions. I mean, it wasn't something that they only suffered from. So that also made me know that we had much to offer the public. We just had to do it. We had to get it out there. And how do you best do it? The same thing with some of the health issues. I mean, women's health was not the same as men's health, and most of the research was on men's health. So how do you get the information out about women's health? And I think as Helen said, if you want to speak to people beyond psychologists, you have to go beyond psychologists. And we had people from pretty much every area. And this, for me, became important because sitting at the Hunt Valley Conference when they announced that there would the Office of Research on Women's Health at NIH and the first director of that office and Pat Cobar, who was our policy person in science, got up during the question and answer period and said, we must remember that to make sure that behavior, psychosocial and behavioral factors are considered. And the person who was talking, introducing this, the new person said, well, that's in NIMH or Adam Hall, because I don't think they had NIMH at the time. And they will deal with those mental health issues. So I said, well, ain't that something, excuse me, in my southern way. And I'm saying, this is ridiculous. And we have to do something about that. And I was talking to Charlie Spielberger, who was then on the board of directors. He might have even been president, I'm not sure. That was a long time ago. But he says, well, why don't you have a conference about it? Okay, went to CWP and they agreed that we could do that. I don't know if Helen was on yet. You were on then. Okay, but we decided we would have a conference. But my clear vision at that time was something not just for psychologists. Psychologists know psychology. But we needed to tell those other people who felt that all we did was mental health. How do they get to know and understand that they have to include psychosocial and behavioral factors in their work on women? And that's why we had women from all spheres of health, and pretty much every agency that dealt with health funded us and participated, and our research agenda became a lot of what was in the research agenda for the Office of Research on Women's Health. So those are some of the things that moved me in the early days. I'm not going to say much else, but in terms of Carolyn Payton's Who Will Do the Hard Things, that's a question I want to ask you, because it's not always easy. Our policy people are concerned that sometimes they have difficulty mobilizing psychologists to go to the Hill to email their Congress people. Many people complain about the National Rifle Association. They write letters, they give money, they do what's necessary to have their agenda forwarded, but we don't. If we want to move psychology, we must do those hard things. And I also must mention my other professor, Martha Mednick, who was another mentor, who said, I mean, if you are a psychologist, I mean, you join APA, and you get active, and you do things. And that's been a message that I have carried forward. There are so many issues. Thank you, Earl, for bringing up some of those that the Directorate is working on now. And one of the hardest things I've had to do is to say, what are you going to work on? Because my thought is, well, this is an issue, the school-to-pipeline issue is something that we need to deal with. We still need to deal with poverty. We need to understand not only why so many of our young kids are in preschool getting put on suspension, but why are we still having such inequities in education? I mean, there's work for us to do. Are we up to doing it? Are we willing to make the sacrifices to do it? But as James and Henry after him would always say to me, you have to prioritize. You can't do everything. But if all of us are working, we can get a lot more done. And to close, I want to thank APA for hiring me, for the work that Henry and James did before me. I want to thank Nancy Russo. I mean, because we all come behind others, and I want to thank those who made a path for us. I also want to thank all of you who have served on BIAPI, BSERP, BEMA, all of our committees. Your work has indeed made a difference, and our task forces, I don't want to forget them. And I want to thank my staff, who I still miss. My husband says that I'm pitiful. I was so accustomed to asking Donnie to do it that I don't know how to do anything. As I said to somebody, I registered myself, but that's not even true. This would have been the first time that I would have registered for a convention in 30 years. It was always done, and I went where I was told that I had to be. So, but anyway, I also want to thank those members of council and the board who were here, because as James said, public interest was not always seen as important. We used to say that we were the stepchild in the APA, that science and practice was what mattered. And if we weren't asking for something that was a problem for them, maybe we'd get it. But things have definitely changed. I mean, we are now taken seriously. I think APA takes seriously that part of their mission that is for the human welfare. APA is not for psychologists, I mean, we, even though it's hard for folk to see that, but it's for the youth, for psychologists' work for the human welfare. So I think that is all. And also the president, the board and council, but also the presidents. Melba talked about her task forces. We had Bonnie's task force, many other task forces where we did much of the work. I mean, they were staffed within public interest and on public interest issues. And I see Pat DeLeon, who I also will thank for work, stress, and health in our NIOSH relationship. Pat and Don Millar, who were instrumental in the APA-NIOSH collaboration, were given awards at the previous NIOSH conference. And as I close, I want to encourage you to continue to do the work. It's weird not being on staff anymore, but I must say that I felt that I could retire and know that my babies were in good hands. And my babies are my projects, and to some extent my staff, some of whom I have seen grow up. I'm a lot older than all of them, I think, except Clinton. Because we're the same age, that's what I mean. But to see staff grow from interns to full-fledged professionals who carry out the work of the Directorate has been truly inspirational in one way, and it's been meaningful because you think you've made a difference not only in the work, but you see people's lives not only in the public, but close up. So, since David mentioned this, I will say the song that I tried to sing, and I think I had gotten nervous and couldn't remember part of what I was trying to sing, which was very embarrassing, was Michael Jackson's Man in the Mirror. And I thought about trying to see if I could have it played today. But I said, oh, that's probably sappy. And so I didn't do it. But for those of you who remember, it's, I'm looking at the man in the mirror. I'm asking him to change his ways. No, nothing could be any clearer. If you want to make the world a better place, just look in the mirror and say, make a change. And that's what I would ask of you, to look in the mirror and tell that man, woman, boy or girl, if you want to make the world a better place, just look at yourself and make a change. Thank you. I had meant to ask you all to make a commitment to that.
We do have a few minutes before we need to end. So if some others in the audience have a question or a comment, I've been asked to repeat things so that it will get on the tape. But if you want to come up and use the mic, that would be fine as well. Please do.
So I'm Ellen Cole, past president of Division 35 NCWP. Gwen, I want to thank you for being my pathway to so many things, and don't make me cry. I don't want to cry. But I do want to say something really funny. When I was president of the Alaska Psychological Association, we invited Gwen to come up and give a talk, and we had some time, and I think it was my husband and I, or we wanted to go on a little hike with Gwen, and so we invited her on a hike in Alaska, very, very gnarly. She only had one pair of shoes with her. They were high-heeled shoes, and she took a hike in Alaska with high-heeled shoes. Thank you.
And we actually, does that mic work?
Pardon? Slide.
So if someone else, we have a mic that, so you don't have to come up to the podium if you would like to say something.
I'd just like to complete the circle, and from a staff perspective, in honoring Gwen, I worked as the women's programs officer for Gwen for quite a few years in the 1990s, so had so much respect for her as a professional and as a boss, but also as a friend. We had a lot of laughs together and a lot of tears together. One incident that was kind of funny was when we took the pro-choice flag on a little march that we weren't supposed to, but a lot of good times with Gwen, and glad that I'll still be a friend for many years.
My name is Jennifer Kelly, and I'm the recording secretary of APA. And I must tell you that when I joined the board, and I would go to the meetings, and I would just see the work that Gwen was doing. And one of the things that I said was that after my first year, I wanted to be liaison to the APA because I wanted to work with Gwen. And it has just been an amazing experience. It's been quite inspirational to me. And one year I didn't get it, and I went to Gwen stomping and fussing, and then she went to Norman, and they got me to be one of the co-liaisons to the Abbey. And the reason why I say that really did happen. Is that right, Gwen? But it was because of your commitment to psychology. And, you know, if you think about psychology is about improving people's lives, that's one of the things that you embody. And it has just been such a blessing to be able to work with you and see that in you. And I always follow that with me. And the beauty now is that Gwen is only 2 hours away from me. And I'm in Atlanta, and she's in Aiken, North Carolina. Yes. South Carolina, that's right, South Carolina. And she's even come to our home for this, I have this diversity brunch, and she drove in the rain for 2 hours to come to it, and that just shows your commitment to diversity, and it's just been such a pleasure to be able to know you, and I'm looking forward to our continued relationship. I learned so much from you. Thank you so much.
Hi, I'm Pam Reed, and I've known Gwen for a really long time. We don't go into the number of years. But so I have to just tell this funny story about how she helped me. Martha Mednick was president of Division 35 and wanted us to have more presence of women of color. And she first had Sandy Rice Murray chair a task force, and then Sandy was moving away from the DC area, so Martha asked me to be the next chair. And I got Gwen to be on the committee, and at first we had a small group of women, and we, you know, came to all the Division 35 Executive Committee meetings and reported very faithfully and energetically what our task force was doing. What they didn't know was that after maybe the first meeting, we called a couple of more meetings, and only she and I showed up. And so we were reporting wonderful things that our task force was doing. But we didn't tell anybody that it was only the whole task force was, which then grew into a section. So so I'd just like to tell you that she has shown these leadership capabilities. Subterfuge is a part of being a good leader. You don't always tell all you know. So just thought I'd share that, Gwen.
Let me just say that this has been very difficult. I appreciate everything that was said, but it's kind of hard sitting, having people talk about you for an hour and a half. So I did want to thank you, but this has been very difficult, and I am glad you all went first, because this was one of the hardest presentations I tried to write, with about 10 different drafts, each going in a different direction. But thank you, but this, it's really hard to listen to this good stuff about you, but thank you.
I'm Barbara Palombi, and I had the honor of being on BAPI. I have no idea how I got on BAPI. I had no idea what it was. I had no idea what all these little alphabetical soups meant or how anything was connected. And I really was like, oh my God, what am I doing here? But I really appreciate Gwen's mentoring and just going like, well, you have a voice. You're bringing in something very different. You're not up in here. You're at the kind of the grassroots kind of level. And from working with her, I was able to go to CDIP and help CDIP become part of the 21st century versus being in the 18th century that they were. And I have to say, I had to leave this work because of a matter at my other work that was due to being disabled, and I had to file an EEOC complaint. And I think because of working with Gwen and BAPI, I had the strength to say, no, I have a voice in this. I am not going to sit here and take this. This is not fair. And let me use the resources that I have. And I really want to say, I really appreciate that from you.
Thank you.